My calculations are correct. When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're gonna see some serious shit.
Travis recently got a chance to sit down with the beautiful Jennifer Westfeldt. Jealous, buddy. I'm a little bit jealous. The writer, director, producer, starring, probably a key grip and a camera operator in there somewhere. Long story short, she did a lot of work on the new upcoming movie, Friends with Kids. If you're within my age range or Travis's age range, mid-20s to mid-30s, you're probably feeling the synopsis of this movie. If you yourself do not have kids, everyone you know wants to show you a sonogram. Well, this movie kind of takes on the role of two people who decide, you know what, we're not going to be the only ones without kids. They try to have a kid together and remain platonic friends. We've seen how that story goes before, but it may turn out differently this time around. So thanks for joining us. Sit back, relax, and take a listen as Travis Hobson of the Punch Drunk Critics talks to Jennifer Westfeldt.
Yeah, she was really struck by one moment in there.
Which one?
It was a small moment, a small scene between your character and your mom.
Uh-huh.
Where she's like, this is my baby, you know. She really dug that part of it.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Do you have kids?
We do not.
Yeah. Do you want them? Or?
She really does. I'm sort of on the fence.
I understand.
I'm sort of on the fence.
I understand. I hope... I don't know then what our movie did for you in that regard.
Better question is, what did it do for you? I mean, writing it, it must have made you think about things, future, whatever, in terms of that kind of stuff.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think the story sort of came out of just so many people in my life having babies in the last 4 or 5 years specifically. I mean, I had a couple of friends who did it earlier, but the bulk of people who I know with kids all sort of seem to do it at once in the last few years. And... it's a funny thing to sort of be out of sync with your peer group and watching them undergo this epic, profound life transition, this forever transition. And to watch the different ways people handle it, and there are so many different ways, it seems. And I think I'm quite blessed that I have some amazing girlfriends in my life who are pretty honest with me about things. And I guess I was struck by... this duality and this theme that kind of kept coming to me from my girlfriends who were becoming moms. And they all described having a child as like experiencing a level of love, like a depth of love and a depth of feeling that's indescribable and incomparable and richer and deeper than anything they've ever known. And at the same time, they all said it's the hardest thing I've ever done in my life.
Right.
And then that part about the challenge part of it, they all were surprised by. They were all like, why didn't anyone tell me this? Like, why didn't anyone say it was going to be this hard and this epic and this challenging? And I appreciated the honesty, and I also just thought, what an interesting thing that these two extreme feelings can be happening at the exact same time. You know, the richest experience of my life, the biggest love, the most profound, unbelievable experience and feeling that you've ever known and had, and also, oh my God, this is the hardest thing ever. And and I think, you know, that's sort of what interested me and what sort of led me to this story.
Okay. No, that's great. I was just thinking while you were saying that about your friends and how they, you know, you see your friends change, and I was thinking how Facebook really shows you how that stuff, because you see every, and I've experienced it myself, where you see all these people putting all their pictures up of their kids everywhere, and it's like, wow, everybody's just having kids all of a sudden.
I don't do any of that stuff. I told you I'm a technological moron, so I'm not on Facebook or Twitter or whatever the kids are doing these days. I don't do. But there is a version of that, even just in Christmas cards. You know, we get, I don't know, 300 cards that's just, it's always just the kids. And and we don't even send out cards because we're like, is it just too dumb to just like have a picture of us and our dog? Like,
it's not quite enough, right?
I don't know. It's funny.
So how did the cast come together? Because this is obviously a great cast. Supporting cast is amazing.
Yeah.
This movie. And it must be awesome that they're so popular right now with, you know, Bridesmaid success. So how did all that come about?
Yeah, I mean, the Bridesmaid success is so amazing and such a happy coincidence, because we wrapped our movie about 4 months before Bridesmaids came out. So no one could have predicted the juggernaut, incredible success that it's had, and it's incredible. But in terms of how the cast came together, John and Adam and I have been friends for, 15 years. So
I was going to ask you about you and Adam Scott, because your chemistry on screen is very good.
Oh, thank
you. So yeah, I was going to ask you if you had been friends beforehand, and if he maybe had any hand in making the movie or anything.
Yeah,
like that.
Adam's been in our life, and his wife Naomi, for a really long time. Mm-hmm. We were at their wedding. We've known them for so long. They're one of our friends with kids. They have two kids, two beautiful kids.
Did it change him too?
Well, it's funny because Adam said this in press, but it's probably, he said it, but it's the most time we've had the chance to spend with him and Naomi since they had kids, because obviously their lives get so busy, and then their new friends who are parents, and it's it's a funny thing. I've joked with him that I wrote the movie just as a ruse to spend more time with you and Naomi. But Adam read the very first draft of the script. The day that I finished the first draft, I invited over some actors to our house, and we had sort of an informal cold reading at our dining room table, and made pasta and poured wine, and I was literally the script was printing as people were I'm highlighting madly, and right. John's getting people drinks, and Adam read that first night, read Jason, and he was amazing, of course, as always. And after that moment, it was just, I couldn't picture anyone else doing it. I was just like, it's Adam or nothing. It's just like, right. we're gonna make it, and it's gonna be Adam, or we're not gonna make it. And that was sort of how I felt from the start. So the three of us were involved early, and then we went to Kristen, and she really responded to this role of Missy, and I think mostly because it just gave her an opportunity to be seen in a different way, and show a different part of her range. We all know how brilliant and amazing she is as a comedian, and she plays a lot of sometimes larger than life characters on SNL, and this is obviously a much quieter, more dramatic part, and I think she's always seeking opportunities to kind of expand the way people see her, and for us it was exciting to think about showing people her tremendous range, that she can do anything. And so she was on board, sort of schedule pending, early, before she even shot Bridesmaids. And then the rest of the group came to us during the casting process, and their agents setting up meetings, and I sat down with Chris O'Dowd. I didn't know his work, and I was just blown away by the level of charm of him. And I always pictured his role as this sort of oversized teddy bear of a guy who is just wildly lovable, and that's Chris. That's just through and through Chris O'Dowd. So, he was an amazing find. And Megan, I only knew sort of her public persona. Right. So when I sat down with Megan, I just found it so remarkable. Here was this unbelievably funny, irreverent, sassy, cool, really smart girl, and and I thought, once again, I was like, that would be so fun to get to show people, that she's wisecracking and free-spirited and funny and cool,
it's
and smart and witty.
Role for
and
her.
Yeah, and I just thought, it's really neat that people don't know that about her yet, and that she's funny and all of those things. And I think that's why she was drawn to it, too. She hasn't really done too much comedy yet, and now she's doing a bunch of comedy, so it's really exciting, I think, to see her career go in a different direction and expand. And, as her career go in a different direction and expand. And, as actors, we're also used to being typecast and only seen one way. I mean, I know after Jessica Stein, I got sent only, lesbian scripts and, super neurotic girl scripts. And even Adam, honestly, when we were first sort of raising the money and putting it together, people who were fans of his from Parks and Rec or from Party Down, they were like, well, no, we get that he's totally, charming and comedic, but, does he have dramatic chops? And I was like, ugh, does he have dramatic chops? Are you kidding? Go rent The Vicious Kind. Go watch Tell Me You Love Me on the HBO series. I've seen him on stage. This guy is amazing, and he can do anything. And so it was exciting to kind of get to show different sides of actors you might think about in one way, and show that they can do anything at all and be incredible, you know?
Did Ed Burns just sort of gravitate to it because he's in every New York indie movie?
So funny. I met Eddie Burns through Will Rexer, who's my DP, my wonderful DP. They're best friends. Their families are best friends. So I met Eddie through Will, and I got to meet him in the context of his family and saw him with his children and with his wife, and they're just the most graceful, charming, lovely people, and he's the easiest father, you know. It's such a, they both are, they're such wonderful parents, and I guess seeing him that way and that ease and that grace that he has as a parent just felt like that's the perfect fit for this part, because the part of Kurt is sort of the only character in the movie who has like an unconflicted relationship with parenting.
It's fine, I'm just checking.
Yeah, but you know what I mean? He's completely at ease with his identity as a parent, first and foremost. And I thought Eddie just kind of suited that to a T, so.
Did you always want to direct the movie?
No.
Was that always your plan? No.
I never thought that I would direct it. We were meeting with a bunch of directors, and Jake Kasdan was going to direct it, sort of schedule
Bad
pending.
Bad Teacher, right?
Bad Teacher, yeah. And many other films, Zero Effect, and the TV set, and anyway, he's a great guy and a great artist, and we were in discussions about it, and we hadn't quite finished Bad Teacher, he was still in post on that, and we didn't really know how much longer the studio would need him on that film, but we really wanted him to direct, and he really wanted to direct, and on an indie, it's so hard to get the casts, you know, the cast that you want to have their schedule line up in that magical, you know, 3.5 weeks that you need. Mm-hmm. And that happened in the dead of winter last year in New York, the worst winter in New York in 45 years or something. And Jake was not going to be available to do prep on the film, so he encouraged me to direct it myself, as did John Sloss, as did John Hamm, as did many of the other producers on the movie. Mm-hmm. And I was daunted and uncertain, but Jake actually sort of struck a deal with me that he would be on the set the days that we were shooting and be a second pair of eyes when I was on screen. And that was the only way that I would accept the job. So that's what we did.
That's a good reason.
Yeah, and honestly, without the support of Jake and Will and John and so many people to kind of help guide me and mentor me through the process. I mean, Will Rexer was so patient during pre-production. I asked him zillions of questions, and I just wanted to make sure I was prepared and wanted to make sure that the way I spoke about something could translate to a crew. And it's just such a steep learning curve. I was terrified.
You wouldn't be the first, I'm sure. I'm sure it's really daunting, as you said.
Yeah.
Talk to me about New York City, because I feel like it's very much kind of a character in the movie.
Yeah.
You seem to have a certain connection to it.
I love New York, you know. I mean, I grew up in Connecticut, but my whole mom's side of the family, they all live in New York, and they always have. So I grew up, and then my dad's side of the family is in Colorado. So I kind of grew up with a Connecticut, New York, Colorado. Those were the three places that I spent time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Thanksgiving's in New York, and I would go to New York for to see Broadway plays on special occasions.
You did work in Broadway, too.
Yeah, I did. I my Broadway debut was in a show called Wonderful Town in 2003-04. And that was amazing. And that was always my dream, was to just be a theater actress and do Broadway. But I've always felt like a New Yorker. That's always the place that felt like home to me. Mm-hmm. Even growing up in Connecticut, you know, we'd go visit our relatives in Manhattan, and I would come home, and I'd be like, I can't believe we live in this provincial town. Like, you know, I was so disappointed to live in a small town after going to the city, and I just couldn't wait to get back. Mm-hmm. And I got there immediately after college, and I've never quite felt the same connection to any other place that I do to New York. It just feels alive to me. I feel connected to people in a way that doesn't feel the same in other places. Chicago's a pretty cool town. I mean, I like cities.
Right.
So.
It shows. Talk to me about working with John Hamm on the movie. I know you guys have been together a while. Was he in Kissing Jessica Stein?
He's
too,
in all of my movies, yeah. Iron Abbey as well.
Yeah. Talk to me about working with him, because to me it was really strange for me watching him we're so used to seeing him as like the alpha male guy.
Yeah.
You know, and he's kind of that guy here, but changed, like kind of beaten down by life a little bit. Talk to me about his role and kind of working alongside him.
Sure. I mean, well, this was the first thing we produced together through our company that we just started 2 years ago. And I think we were excited to have our first project get off the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And this was the role that John was drawn to and that I was drawn to for him.
Mm-hmm.
And mostly because I think his character is obviously in a lot of pain in this movie after the first, you know, first 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And John is such an amazing actor, and I think he's an actor who can make pain and darkness incredibly compelling. As can Adam, as can, you know, many of the people in our cast. But what attracted, I think, John to this role and me having him in this role was that his character, this character of Ben, is the truth teller in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
He's the voice of the audience, really. And he doesn't say it in a nice way. He's in a lot of pain. He's had too much to drink. So it doesn't come out in sort of a gentle or kind fashion. But he's right. Everything he's saying is right. And he's sort of calling us out on this, you know, what seems like a cavalier choice that we've made about the most important of things, which is a child's life. And and so I think it's interesting. It was interesting for us, the kind of duality of, like, someone speaking the truth and being the voice of the audience and the conscience of the film, but being a very flawed person at the same time, you know? So it comes out in a difficult way, and I think that that was exciting. And then I think it was also fun for me to explore sort of the differences between men and women in terms of how they deal with great conflict among dear friends. You know, I think with women it's tears and emotions and drama, and you know, in that bar scene between Adam and John, and their characters. I think, you know, men who have a history, no matter how sort of bad a fight or ugly a moment it is, I think there's actually a great capacity for forgiveness, and they don't even have to talk about it that long.
Right.
You know what I mean?
I know. Yeah.
And
we're easy to forgive each other.
Yeah, and I think that's a uniquely male quality in terms of what I've observed.
I know I've only got time for like one more question, probably, but kissing Jessica Stein, this is kind of away from this movie a little
bit.
Sure. It's been, what, a decade?
It's been 10 years almost to the month, yeah.
Yeah.
10 years ago, March, and so it's so funny that we're opening, like, you know, it's these weird milestones. And Iron Abbey was 5 years. They were all 5-year increments.
That movie would probably be different if it was came out now. A lot has just changed since that time. Do you think you would make them a similar movie, or maybe even revisit those characters in a different place in their lives now?
I don't know. Maybe.
Yeah.
Should I?
I think so. I think it'd be very interesting to see
where they are now.
Exactly.
Yeah, I don't know. I gotta. We'll have to brainstorm about that.
You can even direct it now.
Oh God. I don't know about that.
Oh, I think you've done a good job. I think you'd probably be very good at it if you wanted to.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I appreciate your time. It was really good. And we, like I said, we love the movie. So.
Thank you so much.
No, thank you.
I really appreciate it.
Oh, sure.